If you let me play.
If you let me play sports.
I will like myself more.
I'll have more self-confidence.
If you let me play sports.
If you let me play.
If you let me play.
I'll be 60% less likely to get breast cancer.
I will suffer less depression.
If you let me play sports.
I will be more likely to leave a man who beats me.
If you let me play.
I'll be less likely to get pregnant before I want to.
I will learn.
I will learn what it means to be strong.
To be strong.
If you let me play.
Play sports.
If you let me play sports.
The video just watched was called If You Let Me Play. It was shot in 1995 with the goal of urging women to play sports. Nike spokeswoman Yasir Corpus speaks to the ad saying, "Our message, which is directed to parents, is that sports is no less valuable to women than men." This ad essentially shows parents the advantages of having their daughters play sports. Women should not have to beg to play sports, which is the exact message Nike was trying to tell. Nike wanted viewers to realize women shouldn't have to beg to play sports. If this ad was created in 1995 and Title IX was passed in 72, why, 13 years later, is Nike still trying to spread this message?
Best. You can be the King Kong banging on your chest.
You can beat the world, you can beat the war. You can talk to God, go banging on his door.
You can throw your hands up, you can beat the clock,
yeah.
You can move a mountain, you can break rocks.
You can be a master, don't wait for luck. Dedicate yourself and you go find yourself.
Standing in the Hall of Fame,
yeah.
And the world's gonna know your name. You can run the mile. You can walk straight through hell with a smile.
You could be the hero. You could get gold.
Confident. Mm-hmm. I think times have changed since I played. Where I think when you if you played in my day or even much earlier, you needed to be confident. You needed to be because there was a societal perception of female athletes.
Mm-hmm.
For you guys, it's a bit of the norm. This isn't, you guys, hopefully you're all thinking you should be playing, and it's okay to compete. It's okay to be a female on a field and want to win and want to do whatever it takes to win. Where back in the 80s, the 70s, the 60s for certain, that wasn't okay for women to have that.
UVA assistant lacrosse coach Colleen Shearer talks about what Title IX has done for her.
Well, it's definitely, I mean, I think without Title IX, I wouldn't even have a job. Without Title IX, I would never have been able to play. So clearly, it gave opportunity for kids to play. And then from that, from a career standpoint, it certainly has given me an opportunity to have a career. So without Title IX, I don't even think that I wouldn't even have a job. So yeah, I mean, it's played a huge part in everything that I've done in my life. Absolutely. Well, because I just don't think that we're at a place where minorities, meaning women versus men, that women are going to get equal share of what men get. And that's just, and because of that, you have to be made to do it. Otherwise, people won't do it. Point blank.
Okay.
If they're not made to, if women's sports would be the first thing, you know, no one will. You know, women's sports aren't going to get half the money that men do if they weren't told it. The athletic directors would not do it unless they had to. I still believe that today.
In a recent survey I passed out to the GCS community, I gathered feedback on who would prefer to watch men's basketball over women's basketball and why. Around 90% of the males and all the females who answered said they prefer to watch men's sports. Of the 10% who answered female said they prefer to watch him for their looks. When asked why they prefer to watch men's basketball, 42% of both men and women stated that they watched it for entertainment purposes. Of the male respondents, only 33% stated they watched men's sports because they believe men were better at sports. It is of interest that no females responded this way, which leads to the question, why is there a difference in consumer opinion, and how is this affecting discrimination against female athletes in the 21st century?
Okay, and what sports would you say are a money-making sport today?
Well, you know, you can talk to college. When you're talking about the college level, when you talk about college, if you talk to any men's or women's coach at the college level, if they're being honest with you, they're going to tell you that men's football, obviously, and men's basketball are what keep the other sports alive.
The current charts that are about to be shown are examples of discrimination in the 21st century. It was taken from the NCAA's Gender Equity Report from the years 2004 to 2010. It focuses on the revenue each gender brings in, as well as each sport. It also focuses on where that money is going.
This first chart is focusing on how much revenue the median school is bringing in. It then breaks it down to each gender and how much each gender is bringing in. The chart shows about a 3-to-1 ratio, with the men bringing in a little over $7 million and the women bringing in around $2 million. Football brings in the majority of the revenue for a college. Since there are no women's football teams, including football, skews the data. With football out of the equation, it is easier to compare how much revenue each gender brings in on a sport-to-sport basis. Without football, the numbers drastically change. Men are now bringing in about 55% of all revenue, whereas the women are bringing about 45%. The next chart recorded shows how the money is used for each gender. It is no surprise that men have a higher budget than women due to the fact that they have a higher fan attendance. But what is interesting about these charts is that the money is going to completely different places for both the men and the women. The men's and women's expense budget charts focus on the marketing and growth of the team, such as coaching salaries, recruiting, equipment and supplies and facilities, admin salaries, marketing, and the marketing and promotion of each sport. It also includes financial aid, showing how much of the generated revenue goes towards scholarships. The men use a large proportion of the money they bring in on expenses such as tools that will help the team develop and the marketing and promotion of their teams. The women do a fairly good job at balancing out what money goes to the team and marketing and what money goes to the individual. When you compare the men's other expenses to the women's other expenses, men use about 62% of the budget compared to the women, who use about 53%. On the other hand, 38% of that revenue men bring in go towards the financial aid, but women use about around 47% of their revenue. The money that is used to develop the team and marketing will bring in viewers. Since financial aid is granted by the ratio of dollars given to both men and women to the ratio of their participation in athletics, money is essentially being allocated in the wrong area if we are trying to promote women's sports. Women are getting more money for individual reasons rather than growing and developing their programs. Opportunities for women have been growing at a rapid pace ever since the enactment of Title IX. There is not much discrimination against playing opportunities for women, but today, money is being allocated for marketing in different ways. Women get more financial aid, as previously shown, but this chart shows the disparity of marketing dollars. Men are receiving a more dramatic amount of money to market for their program compared to women. This is why women's sports is having trouble gaining recognition. Because programs have the ability to allocate money however they choose, they can place the money that could potentially benefit one program over the other. The way society has perceived specific sports has affected the amount of revenue each gender brings in. Men who play sports that are perceived as masculine tend to bring in the majority of the money for that sport, whereas women who participate in sports perceived as feminine bring in majority of the money for their individual sport programs. According to Andrea Polian, ice hockey is regarded as a masculine sport, whereas gymnastics is considered more of a feminine sport. Because society recognizes men as being masculine, they prefer to watch the men's team over the women's. Gymnastics, on the other hand, is perceived as a feminine sport, allowing women to bring in majority of the viewers. Essentially, stereotypes are playing a role in what sports society chooses to watch. In another survey taken by GCS, I examined perceived stereotypes of athletes. When they were asked to choose a specific gender, or both, for the word strong, around 90% of the males who took the survey answered men, and only 10% answered both. Out of the women who took the survey, 80% answered both, and around 20% answered males. The next word they were asked to genderize was aggressive. Out of the males, 90% answered men, and 10% answered women. Females who took the survey answered both. Out of the statistics gathered, there was a biased answer towards their specific gender. This survey shows that since majority of men watch sport, it is possible that majority of men are biased towards their own gender. This could influence what sports they enjoy to watch. This also shows that the possibility of having the amount of men in the sports fan base is affecting the ongoing stereotyping of women. Today, we are finding more and more female athletes are becoming branded. Magazines are perpetuating this stereotype by having women being shot in suggestive poses and clothing, even nude. Unfortunately, women do not have the luxury of being portrayed as just an athlete because their beauty and sex appeal tends to overshadow their athleticism. This leaves the viewers seeing them as women first and an athlete second. Because women's sports are not yet up to par with men's sports in the eyes of the American public, these women are having to use their body and image as a female in order to get recognition. For women, it is easier to gain the public eye through their body image. When women do not have that feminine physique, they are deemed as masculine or lesbian. Is she smart? Can she hold a decent conversation? Is she a decent person? Does she do community service? We don't talk about that stuff. Is she hot? Okay, says Anna Kournikova in the 9 for 9 video. Anna Kournikova makes more money through her endorsements, which emphasize her looks compared to her career in tennis. Many women who take a stand against this way of gaining publicity are judged by their viewers and peers. By refusing to participate in these sexual portrayals, they have become heavily criticized by society, especially males. According to Mark O'Keefe, a national correspondent for the News House News Service, they argue that female athletes should just lighten up and seize the opportunity to glorify their bodies while raising awareness for women's sports, as having such opportunities should be a source of pride rather than a shame. Women are finding it harder and harder to say no to these magazines, advertisements, and broadcasts because it has become such a popular trend and, in a sense, the only way to gain publicity from both male and female viewers. During the 2012 basketball Final Four, the Kentucky vs. Louisville game had an 8.4 household coverage rating, while the Ohio vs. Kansas game had a 9.6 rating. Unlike the men, the women's had a dramatically lower rating. The Notre Dame game versus the University of Connecticut had a 2.1 rating, while the Baylor versus Stanford game had a 2.6 rating. It is needless to say, the women are underrepresented when it comes to the coverage of sports. In a recent study, University of California's professor Michael Messner recorded commentary about both men and women's sports events. They found that by putting pink on the television screen during the women's games, viewers were reminded that they were watching females. Also, the commentators' gender marked competitions in order to have a sense of clarity for the viewers. When viewers were constantly being reminded that they were watching women's sporting events by either the graphics or the female commentators, people were less likely to show an interest in what was going on. By the media trying to target these male viewers, they are essentially doing harm because they are failing to engage men in women's sports. The media believes the only way to get male attention is to engage them sexually. By this, they are distracting men from the true essence of women's athletics by focusing only on female athletes' sex appeal and debasing their identities. This theory has reinforced the typical stereotypes and kept males viewing female athletes as not entertaining. Advertisements have long been a part of the sports culture. Whether intentional or not, these commercials sometimes portray the female athletes simply as your stereotypical female. They tend to focus more on the feminine form and less on the female athlete's true ability.
Marvelous chance to win. Concentration will also serve entertainment.
I feel pretty, oh so pretty.
I feel pretty and witty.
And bright.
And I pity
any girl who isn't me tonight.
I feel charming.
Oh, so charming.
It's alarming how charming I feel.
I'm so pretty.
That I hardly can believe I'm real.
See that pretty girl in the mirror there?
Who can that charming girl be?
Such a pretty face.
Such a pretty dress.
Such a pretty smile.
Such a pretty name.
I feel pretty.
Oh, so pretty.
I feel pretty and witty
and bright.
And I pity
anyone who needs. In Nike's ad, I Feel Pretty, featuring Maria Sharapova, society's view of female athletes is displayed. As Sharapova makes her way to her tennis match, she is surrounded by people who are singing the famous song, I Feel Pretty. This video is showing what people think of her when she walks by. She is depicted in the beginning as just a pretty face, but once she steps up to play her match, the crowd is silenced when they realize she is more than just that. The fact that people are so stunned she is more than just a pretty face shows exactly how society perceives female athletes today. This ad shows how society is still stuck on old-fashioned stereotypes. People automatically see her as a female first, but once she begins to play, they are so stunned she actually has athletic ability. It shows how society first views female athletes as just pretty faces, and then an athlete second. Although this ad is not considered sexist, this video is simply a constant reminder that the body and looks come before the actual talent. Of Samsung's commercial is unknown, it does not stop the viewers from enjoying it. These two women are juggling a soccer ball, something all soccer players do, but this is different. They are all dressed in lingerie. When solely focused on the feet, the viewers notice their talent, but as soon as the camera exposes the whole body, their talent is overshadowed by their looks. The camera tends to focus more on the pleasing objects of a female's body to capture the attention of the men. Men do not solely focus on the women's athletic ability like they do the men. They tend to focus more towards the women's appearance. Again, they are portrayed purely as a sexual object. Their athleticism cannot compete. In order for female athletes to be equal to that of men's in the eyes of society, women need to be perceived as belonging in the sports world. Colleges need to put more money towards growing women's teams and programs rather than awarding their individual financial aid. Advertisers need to eliminate the sex appeal in the media and try to make marketing more generic. By eliminating their typical stereotypes from sports media, it will direct the viewer's attention at something else rather than their feminine qualities. In order to move on from these stereotypes, we have to implement an affirmative action program similar to what American society did for race and gender equality. Women were once not allowed to be in the workforce. Having jobs was against their cultural expectations. Today, women get that same education as men and are obtaining an equal status in the workforce. Women have become accepted in the workforce, so it is possible for women to become accepted in athletics. While Title IX has tried to create equality between the two genders, it has mostly affected their participation rates. There needs to be something more structured and specific that truly creates equality. In the early 1900s, the Summer Olympics started with two events for women and has dramatically increased to 140 in the 2012 Summer Olympics. This shows that there has been increasing opportunities for women, but it is possible to continue to grow the image of the female athlete. Society just needs to accept these females for who they are, athletes.